Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. The Institute for Mathematical Sciences, or IMS in short, is a university-level research institute at NUS. Its mission is to promote interest and research in the mathematical sciences and their applications. It organizes thematic programs and brings together foreign and local mathematicians and scientists of diverse backgrounds for interaction, cross-fertilization of ideas, and collaboration in research. It also organizes public lectures like this one to promote public awareness of the role of the mathematical sciences in other disciplines, and also lectures to schools and math camps to stimulate students in their study of mathematics. This evening's public lecture is jointly organized by the Institute and the NUS Department of Mathematics in conjunction with the NUS Department of Statistics and Applied Probability and the Singapore Mathematical Society. We are pleased to have Professor David Donohoe of Stanford University as the speaker. Professor Donohoe studied at Princeton University as an undergraduate and did his PhD at Harvard University. He joined the University of California at Berkeley as a faculty in 1984, becoming full professor in a relatively short span of 6 years. He left Berkeley in 1990 to join Stanford University and has been there since then. He is currently Professor of Statistics and the N. and Robert Bass Professor of Humanities and Sciences at Stanford University. Professor Donohoe is one of the most distinguished statistical scientists in the world. His groundbreaking research in data analysis and reconstruction is widely used. This work finds application in a number of different areas, ranging from medical imaging to seismology and to astrology. His recent work used wavelets and other novel mathematical tools to help scientists get sharper signals and images. Honored for his fundamental work in statistical sciences, he was elected to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences in 1992 and the National Academy of Sciences USA in 1998, and he was also awarded the prestigious MacArthur Fellowship in 1991 to 1996. I'd like to add that at a time when Professor Donohoe was elected to the National Academy of Sciences, he was the youngest after Tukey, am I right? He was the youngest after John Tukey, who was his teacher at Princeton. It is now my great pleasure to invite Professor Donohoe to deliver his lecture entitled The Romance of Hidden Component. David.
Well, thank you for the nice introduction, and I have to say that I have a small amount of intimidation here, because in the United States, public speaking is something of a lost art, and everyone talks about the public's attention span being very short and everything having to be measured in terms of sound bites. But the other evening, I watched a talk that went on for 3 hours by your prime minister. I realize that you have much longer attention spans here than we do in the United States. And I'm not sure that I am used to that sort of environment where I'll get full attention for the full span of time I'm allowed. In any event, I'll try to give some more depth to the presentation than I ordinarily would with a shorter attention span audience. I want to talk about a notion that arose in statistics that is widely used now and is being generalized in very interesting ways, has implications in all sorts of different fields. I think it's very exciting, and that many people can use almost immediately in their daily work. I also wanted to talk about this because I think it's one of those situations where a lot of us are working in one aspect of this problem and are aware that there are tools like this out there in a general way, but we don't see the full picture. So I hope to draw some of the full picture for you, make you interested in this set of tools, which I do think have a certain romantic feel about them, and I'll try to sketch out what some of the enthusiasm is about. So I'll start with the notion of principal components. That arose almost 100 years ago in the work of statisticians who... the two statisticians depicted here, first of all, Carl Pearson, who was working in the late 1800s in England through the early 1900s, and Harold Hotelling, an American working from the teens through the 40s. Both very influential in statistical theory, and I'll try to explain what the notion of principal components means by an example. So first of all, just to get us all going, let me remind you of the notion of a statistical data set, which underlies a lot of what we'll be talking about. Here I've got an array of data that can be put in a rectangular form, as I'll show you in a moment. So I have an array of data where it's measuring the properties of n individuals, and the characteristics being measured I call variables, and there are p of those. I arrange that in a table that's got n rows, one for each individual, and it's got p columns. And just to give an idea of a particular data set that most of us will appreciate since we're in an academic setting, we'll take the results on graduate student qualifying exams in the Department of Mathematics at a university in the United States. So there were 25 different students, and each one under this graduate program had to take five different exams. The first exam was on differential geometry, the second one on complex analysis. There were exams on algebra, real analysis, and statistics. So each individual was represented by five numbers, making that person, in some sense, a point in a five-dimensional space. Now, when we depict the full table of information, it would look something like this. There being the different individuals going down this way, individuals 1 through 25 in this case, and then the scores that they made on the different exams going across. And so we fill out a table that's n by p, and here only a part of that table is shown. I'm spending the time to sketch this out in detail so you'll appreciate the universality of data tables of this kind, and then we'll be able to go quicker later in the talk where I talk about other kinds of data. So here we have the variables and we have the individuals. And since each individual is characterized by five numbers, the person's performance in some sense places us in a five-dimensional space. Now, if we just take two of those numbers and depict them as follows, where the differential geometry score goes along this axis and the statistics score goes along that axis, then each person becomes a point in a two-dimensional space. For example, this individual had a score around 60 and a score around 30 here. So they're much better in differential geometry than they are in statistics, whereas this individual is quite good in statistics, not so good in differential geometry, and this person is doing an excellent job of both. Now, notice that scores are correlated, which means that people tend to do about the same on the two tests, which is to say that you're near the diagonal here, and it's rather infrequent to see someone who's far away from the diagonal. And that means that in some sense, there's a common factor that underlies performance. Some people are better on tests than others. Now, the idea that people had starting about 100 years ago is that you could fit a model to the data which modeled it as roughly an ellipsoid, as indicated here. Ellipsoids, as you know, have two principal axes. There's, in this case, the axis that goes along the longest direction and the axis along the shortest direction associated with the ellipse. And these were then called the principal axes of the data set. In some sense, a coordinate system for understanding the data, which was naturally derived from the properties of the data itself. And the first principal component of the data is basically the coordinate along this axis here. The second principal component is the coordinate along this axis here. The fact that the data spread a great deal along this axis that you see visually has a great deal of significance for the interpretations of this method. In a way, we're saying that if you didn't know anything else but one number, you'd just want to know that single coordinate, and then you'd know quite a bit about the individual. The second coordinate being relatively less important, there being less variation. So those geometric features that we just saw are summarized here in a number of buzzwords. So there's the concentration ellipsoid that's associated with the data. There's the notion of the axes that derive from that, and in particular, the principal axis. The axes, which are in some sense longer, correspond to the ones where there's more variation going on in the data, more things happening. And what you'll often see in applications of this idea to real data is that there'll be a few axes fitted to the data by this technique where there's a great deal of variation, and then most of the axes will have very little variation. If that happens, then that means that even though we're nominally in some high-dimensional space, 5 dimensions or more, depending on the application, it could be that only a few coordinates are necessary in order to summarize the information. Okay, so some basic sloganology that goes with the technique. And this was known pretty clearly 100 years ago. Here's a graphic taken out of Pearson's 1901 paper. So he indicates schematically a scatter plot and a concentration ellipsoid. There's this concept here of the principal axis. It wasn't called that in Pearson's time, but it was later invented as terminology by Harold Hotelling. So this was called the line of worst fit, the line of best fit in 1901. Now, we were just in 2 dimensions until this point, but the benefit of this technique is that it really works for dealing with high-dimensional data. Now, these scores of these individuals place us in a 5-dimensional space, which I can't easily visualize for you, but just to indicate that what's interesting is to go to higher dimensions, I've indicated here there's a 3-dimensional space that has the previous data, statistics and differential geometry, but in addition it has the algebra scores. Now, there's actually a 5-dimensional space that I can't depict, but it turns out that we can fit an ellipsoid to the 5-dimensional data, and when we do that, we come up with the axes that are best adapted to this set of scores. The axes that you come up with, the first 3 coordinates turn out to explain 95% of the variation that's present in the data, so they're the only thing that are important to know about. And if you look at how the axes point in space, you can interpret those as being certain summaries of the raw data. So for example, the first principal component, which explains about 80% of all the variation that's present in the data, is just simply, in some sense, the total of all of your scores. And so it's just saying you do well on all the tests. So if you know the test score total, you know quite a bit about the individual. And the other 2 components are very interesting contrasts. One component basically says, are you good at statistics or are you good at differential geometry? The other one says, are you good at real analysis or are you good at statistics? It's indicating that there's different mental faculties or perhaps dispositions. We don't know what the cause of these things is, but they seem to be actual coordinates where we could describe someone. There's people who are good at tests, there are people who are better at statistics than differential geometry, and then there are people who are better at real analysis than statistics. and you can be sort of mapped into a three-dimensional space using these concepts. Okay? Is this all clear for everyone at this point? Because we're going to get more high-dimensional and things will be more complicated, so I don't want anyone left behind. Okay, no questions? Fine. So, when these notions came out 100 years ago, it wasn't like today where everyone has data and everyone has burning issues associated with data. In fact, the people who were pioneers in gathering data and trying to interpret it 100 years ago were not who you'd think they'd be. They were not the physical scientists and so on who didn't have massive data collections under the way. They were actually people who were interested in education and educational testing because they were used to the idea of measuring performance of individuals through tests and trying to understand that. So in journals of educational psychology were where there was a lot of discussion about methods like this, and two pioneers were Spearman and Thurstone. Spearman in 1904 pointed out that there was a single factor that seemed to explain tests on many different levels of performance. So when you looked at tests for classics, common sense, musical pitch, French, cleverness, whatever that means, English, mathematics, and so on, he claimed that there was a single factor that could explain most of what was going on in all of those simultaneously, which he called G. And G was then later used as the origin of notions like IQ testing. And he pointed out that all of these tests correlated very highly with his notion of general intelligence, and except for a few things like music and your ability to judge weights with your just physical attributes and things like that. There were people who were very good at judging physical things, but they couldn't answer questions very well about classics. But surprisingly, you know, people did very well on classics and on common sense together, which is not the way that you would have thought. Okay. About 30 years later, Thurstone came along and said, no, Spearman is wrong, because Spearman is saying that there's a one-dimensional attribute that summarizes everybody. That's G, this notion of general intelligence. And actually, the world is more complicated. There are several dimensions. So although I've started out talking about the existence of several dimensions, for many years after some of these notions came along, people thought there was just one dimension, and that led to IQ testing. So Thurstone had some examples in his paper, some of which were quite provocative, and they pointed to, let's say, the controversial nature of some of this kind of research. Simply because the research was about people and their attitudes and abilities, it was bound to be that it was controversial. And out of his first paper in an address to the American Psychological Association, you see the following. He found a two-dimensional representation of a high-dimensional data and mapped into that your responses on many different questions of an opinion nature. So, for example, there were questions that measured your patriotism, your attitude towards birth control, towards divorce, towards Germans, towards going to church on Sundays, towards God and church, towards war, and towards communism. And as you can see, if you just, some of you won't be close enough to see this. I'm sorry, there's people for some reason don't want to be very close. But actually, so patriotism, God, church, and so on are in over here somewhere. Attitude towards evolution, divorce, and communism are over here. But the key thing is he mapped into a space the point for getting a high test score on intelligence. And he pointed out that it was tended to be over here towards birth control, evolution, divorce, and communism. Well, as you can see, that was the beginning of the political problems of universities right there. Because obviously, as soon as you're starting to put intelligence over here opposite from patriotism, you're going to have trouble with your government. In any event, this whole line of research was conducted by people working in mental testing, And for a variety of reasons, this ultimately became discredited. And one reason was that the people who were so interested in measuring human abilities and in making use of that information were associated with a movement called eugenics. And unfortunately for them, eugenic ideas were later adopted by the Nazis. And in various ways, the whole concept of what these people were trying to do became discredited. Nevertheless, it didn't stop people from this idea of taking high-dimensional measurements, trying to reduce them down into a lower-dimensional space and understand what they could learn from that. So a very creative idea was developed in the early 1950s, again in psychological context. Torgerson, in Psychometrica, came up with the idea that if you have measurements about individuals or issues, something, and all you can do is judge the similarity of the individuals or the issues, it's possible to map those individuals or issues into a Euclidean space for presentation, even though the issues are quite abstract. And as a way to understand this, we should recognize that, in fact, if all we knew were the distances between, say, cities on a map, we could always reconstruct the map. So, for example, in the United States, many times when you get a road map, they'll have a matrix inside the map that shows for each city the distance to each other city. And if you were ever in a situation where, with your wife, you both of you needed a map and you only had this one map and you didn't have a photocopy machine, well, you could just tear off the matrix, give your wife the map, and then from the matrix you could reconstruct the map for yourself later at leisure. And the point is that just these distances between the cities is enough to reconstruct the map, except for you won't know which way is north. But you have to supply common sense. Okay, in any event, a very simple way to do it is by triangulation. If you know the distances between three different cities, then basically by a triangulation idea, you can figure out their relative positions. Because say the first city's here, then I'll talk about it offline for those who don't see the technique. In any event, just from the distances, you can completely reconstruct the general positions, provided you know which way is north and which way is east and west. And here's an example from a simple textbook indicating the idea. Now, Torgerson's idea looks on the surface to be different from the principal components idea that I was talking about, but the underlying technology, the mathematics that makes this work, is exactly the same. And this is sometimes called principal coordinates analysis. Other times it's called metric multidimensional scaling. But if you have the eigenvalue routines that allow you to do principal components, you can do this kind of analysis. So it is a unified technique, although it appears quite different. Well, Torgerson used this for idea of taking data about the agreement between different senators in the United States Senate. And if two senators were said to be similar if they tended to vote the same way on the same issues. And then you get a measure of correlation between two senators based on how frequently they agree in their votes. Well, that allowed for this kind of map to be presented, where each point on the map is one senator. And what you can see here is that there's a two-dimensional representation of these points where primarily you have Republicans here, primarily Democrats here. These S's over here stand for Southerners. At the time that this was done, the senators from the South had a completely different political organization than the traditional national political parties. There were a few outliers where there's some D's that are mixed in with the R's, and you can go in and see that there are senators who call themselves Democrats, but they voted exactly like Republicans and so on and so forth. Okay. Well, again, this is a politically controversial idea to sort of map these individuals into this space and start talking about them in this way. But the analysis really showed that, in fact, The underlying data really were two-dimensional. So if you look at those the lengths of the underlying principal axes that are behind the solution, what you see is that in fact that 70% of all the total length is just in the first component, and then almost all that's left is in the second one, and there's almost nothing going on in higher dimensions. So that essentially this little wheel here really represented the politics of the situation. Even though there were hundreds of things that these people voted on, you could understand how someone was going to vote just by knowing two numbers, their coordinates in this space. And then you could predict all of their votes with a great deal of accuracy. Okay, now, because this was about political science or psychological testing, and because it was associated with some unsavory things, these ideas have always been a little bit controversial if you come from a classical statistical background. So there's a lot of, let's say, easy criticism that one could make, saying that it's a kind of phrenology. If you remember, in the 19th century, people measured the bumps on people's skull, and they made all sorts of interpretations based on those bumps. And one could say that you're doing the same thing with data in this case. There's no reason that these things should be real. You're just taking the data and mapping it in a persuasive way, but why should we trust any of this? There are several answers to that. One of those is to use classical statistical ideas of statistical inference to check for the validity of the analysis and whether the conclusions are well supported by the data. And I'll leave that out at the moment, although there are plenty of statistical courses here that would describe that approach. The other one is to try to ask if the objects that are being constructed are in some sense real. And I think the main issue from a serious intellectual perspective is whether these mathematical constructions based on the use of certain kinds of computational tools are revealing for us something that's quite reliable. So a particular quotation that illustrates the substance of the criticism of these methods goes back to John Stuart Mill, where he says, basically, people always commit the fallacy of believing that just because something has a name, it therefore is real or is a valid, reliable thing. And we always have to think that just because something has a name, it may not be any more real than anything else that could be a fantasy or a mistake. Okay, so we have to keep in mind the idea that these notions reify by giving us a feeling of concreteness to something that may not be real. It may not be that there is a thing called IQ in some sense. There may not be like an organ in the body that's responsible for IQ, and IQ may not be a real thing in that concrete sense. And I'll try to come back to that later, but I just want you to remind yourself of that. Okay, so what are my goals for today? My goals are, first of all, I hope that I've gotten you started on understanding some of these notions. I want to talk about the notion of hidden components a little more generally and establish that it is a dignified thing and we're not having hallucinations about factors that aren't real. Then I want to talk to you about some of the application areas that are emerging because of the massive ongoing growth in data collection efforts in every field of science and technology. And then I'll talk to you about a whole bunch of new hidden component models that are coming along and going way beyond principal components and giving all sorts of new stimulating results. And then invite you to participate by looking into this a little more. Okay, so hidden components is an old story if you happen to look at it from the point of view of the underlying math. The idea of fitting ellipsoids and looking at the length of those axes and so on, the math of that is identical to some tools coming out of mathematical physics and going back to the very earliest days of founding of mathematical physics. So if you look at Newton's sketchbook, when he was actually just in his early 20s, he figured out that if you use a prism and you separate light out into colors, that those colors in some sense were indivisible themselves. Here, from his notebook, there's an experiment here indicating diffracting light through a prism and then through a second prism in order to check whether something happens the second time. And the second time you go through a prism, nothing happens, the color stays the same. He convinced himself that there was some stable and indivisible aspect there that was important. We now understand that because through the wave theory of light, you're dividing light into its different frequencies or sinusoidal components. Fourier's insight is depicted here. He won a prize for figuring out how heat diffused. And his idea was that if you took, let's say, the temperature contrast along a bar that's going from 0 to 2 pi, and there were a hot spot along the bar, and this is the background temperature, that you could figure out what would happen at later times by a kind of strange procedure. First of all, represent the initial temperature contrast as a superposition of sinusoids, and then secondly, calculate the damping in the amplitude of those sinusoids that happens over time. Then recombine all the sinusoids and you get something that he said represented the temperature profile at some later time. Okay, this seemed to be an extremely complicated way of looking at things. However, we recognize it today that, in effect, the Fourier analysis of breaking things into sinusoids was just Newton's prism applied, in some sense, to heat, and that studying how the different colors, so to speak, damped out was exactly the right procedure for understanding this problem. So he recognized that the hidden components of heat in this case were sinusoidal, and by a kind of prism that he constructed called Fourier analysis, he was able to separate out into those. So post facto, we learned that sinusoids are fundamental not just for heat, but for many other physical phenomena, and in fact, the original light waves that we were talking about that are separated out by the prism all have something to do with sinusoids. A dominant trend in mathematical physics through the following century was to propagate the same insight into many different phenomena of physical interest. So the idea and the math behind it is the same as the math of principal components. That is to say, eigenvalues of symmetric, positive, definite operators, and so on and so forth. Another point is that the idea of getting coordinates for abstractly given data up in a high dimension that you can't see, there's also an august tradition that this draws on. So Gauss recognized at some point, I should have a piece of paper if I could just borrow this. Gauss recognized, you know, in the early 1800s, that in some sense, if you take a piece of paper and it's flat like this, or if you curl it up, that it's to a bug that walks around on the piece of paper and only knows about things based on how long it takes that bug to walk from one place to another, the bug actually doesn't know if things are curved because it doesn't change any distances for the bug at all. And so in some sense, from the point of view of knowing only the distance geometry, the bug doesn't know the difference between this and something that's all curled up in space like that. So he worked out the notion of Gaussian curvature, and Riemann worked out notions of abstract high-dimensional manifolds and distances on manifolds and so on and so forth. Of a more popular flair, there was a movie recently, Beautiful Mind, and I guess I was an undergraduate, and I knew John Nash, who doesn't look like this and didn't write on windows like that either. But that's more like what he looked like and looks like today. But anyway, he worked out the problems of if you have a Riemannian manifold, that is just a space where you know how far it is from place to place by essentially walking around as a little bug, when can that be mapped into Euclidean space so it can be presented in a way that you could understand concretely? And that was one of his main mathematical efforts, although not the one for which he got the Nobel Prize. Okay, so there's actually a very solid tradition behind these notions of hidden components and hidden coordinates that we're talking about. Now, what's at stake in using the ideas that I'm talking about is that we're in some sense experiencing a one-time transition in human affairs where we're suddenly gathering massive amounts of data of a very high-dimensional kind. And that data is being used to address problems, whether we're talking about biomedical or cosmological or of any different kind. So you hear about vast efforts underway, for example, to catalog all the galaxies out at the greatest possible redshifts in order to understand issues, for example, about how much dark energy and dark matter are out there. These are supposedly new forms of energy and matter that aren't sensible to the ordinary physical forces that we're comfortable with. We want to know more about them, and our technique for doing that is to gather data. We want to know more about genetics of diseases. Our technique is to use genomics and gather data from DNA microarrays about patients who have various syndromes. So we're gathering massive data sets, and it's true that in all the places where those data sets are being gathered, principal components analysis is being used. So I want to first sketch out some of this activity, what it means to get high-dimensional data. Then I want to talk about how you really need more than these original principal components ideas in order to make rapid progress in these fields. So let's just talk about some data that we're all aware of. Everybody now has megapixel cameras. A few years ago, they were not very common. But it's possible for me to make massive databases based on just the idea of, let's take a bunch of pictures, for example, of faces of people, and we'll create an array where the rows in the array correspond to the individuals, and the columns in the array correspond to different pixels. So what we've got then is an array where xij, I indexes which photograph we're talking about, and j indexes which pixel we're talking about. Whereas before we had five-dimensional data for those students, and we were talking about measurements of their algebra score and differential geometry scores of five dimensions, when you have a megapixel camera, you're in a million-dimensional space. This is a million pixels, and so there's a million columns going that way. Okay? Still, even though that seems overwhelming, we can build up databases of students or whatever we like, human identification. We could use this for a variety of purposes. And just to illustrate how images correspond to databases in a concrete way for some of you that this is not obvious, I've taken here an image, and I've just taken little patches out of the image, and each one of those is a little small image that doesn't have a million pixels in it, but just a smaller number, so it's good for demonstration. So the individual patches that I get look like so. Now, those are presented as little imagelets, right? But what I want to do now is blow them up so I see the individual pixels. Each pixel corresponds to a number that's being measured by the camera indicating the luminance of that particular place. Now what I want to do is say that pixel corresponds to the first column and that's the second column and so on. And I want to unzip this and I create that row. And if I unzip this, I create that one and so on. And in this way I've played them out. But actually what I'm depicting here is numbers, right? That is to say, there's a number for the brightness of each one of these things. And if I look up those numbers, then I've created an array of data, which is just the same kind of thing I've been talking about before. So you could well use principal components or the other techniques we'll talk about on data like this. Another example would be that we have an array of sensors. This is important in many fields. A simple example would be EEG, where we gather signals from a person's scalp. So here an individual has an array of sensors on their scalp, and then each one of those sensors gives you a time series. So you get an array of numbers from each sensor, and then you have several sensors, and you combine all of those to create a record for that one individual. And here's what's indicated with a heat map is, you know, some concept that they're trying to map to say where on the brain is something happening. That's the ultimate scientific payout that they're trying to get, but we won't discuss that in any detail. Hyperspectral imagery would be another example of high-dimensional data. When you have your megapixel camera, it's basically sensing red, green, and blue. Okay, but you can buy cameras that are much more sophisticated that sense the whole spectrum of light. So when Newton broke light into all the colors of the rainbow, there are cameras that do that on a pixel-by-pixel basis. And so what you can see at a certain pixel is how much light there is at each one of those different wavelengths that makes up a kind of a microcolor. And you see that there's something different for the whites of the eyes and something different when you talk about, let's say, inside the iris and so on. Okay? So actually, it's possible to know not just the color of something, but in detail pretty much what the composition chemically of a given pixel is directly from these kinds of sensed measurements. But it's very high dimensional because associated with each pixel, instead of three numbers that give you red, green, and blue, you could have 16,384 numbers in one commercial camera. And this is just the beginning of things. Okay, another example would be image sequences, because we'll show movies later. So now we're in a media society and people, you can have movies where people gesture with their faces and so on. And so that movie, even it's a sequence of images, but if you sort of unzip the movie across the frames, then you create, again, a very high dimensional data, and it's possible to do principal components of movies or anything you want. Okay? So we can get very high dimensional data. I just gave you these examples as little tasters of things going on in different areas. There are many, many different fields and many kinds of different high dimensional data. In every case, people are going to very, very high dimensions. And these tools that I want to talk about are very helpful in dealing with that. Okay, so you can take the principal components of the face data set and you get sort of the principal face. And then there are other axes. Each one of these faces corresponds to an axis. And each person can be located in the space of faces by taking a linear combination of these different things and summing them up with the appropriate coordinates. Okay, so when you use these techniques, they're giving you a new coordinate system. Instead of measuring pixels, you measure a different attribute and you locate people by a different coordinate system. Similarly, if you look at hyperspectral imagery of someone's hand, the first three principal components from a database that was gathered show different properties. Here you see just properties of the skin. The third principal components tells you properties of the arterial and venous flows, and there's other issues that are handled in each different component. Okay? Now, we need to go beyond principal components. It's very useful, and it's essential for all of these high-dimensional data sets that you think about techniques that allow you to reduce dimensionality or allow you to find a set of axes that are adapted to the data. This is crucial. However, it's not the only way to do it. Essentially, principal components is assuming that our high-dimensional data live basically concentrated in ellipsoids up in this high-dimensional space that we can't necessarily see. Or an alternate way to put it is that there's a flat hyperplane that all the data are close to. You can motivate it through one of those two assumptions. But the important generalizations for many scientific and technology areas will be when you have non-ellipsoidal concentration or non-hyperplane structure. And so now I want to get into these things that go beyond the original idea. Some recent hidden components models include sparse components, which I'll say a lot about, a tool developed in Vision, independent components analysis, which is closely connected, and non-negative matrix factorization. And for time reasons, I can only sort of hint at what some of these things will do. I'll spend the most time on the sparse components analysis. But once you know the buzzwords, you can easily, through a Google search, do more if they seem interesting. Okay, sparse components analysis says we don't like ellipsoids. What we like are octahedra. Okay, an octahedron is some sort of high-dimensional variant of taking two pyramids and putting them, gluing them together. So there are axes just like there are with ellipsoids, but instead of a rotund shape that we're used to, it's actually built around this kind of faceted structure. And there's a mathematical equivalence coming out of approximation theory, which says that if an object can be sparsely represented with the right kind of basis functions, then in some sense it sits inside of either an octahedron or a cognate kind of object. And so I'm using octahedra as a symbol for a whole class of similar bodies. Independent components analysis says we like boxes. So we like things where there are axes and then there's a particular kind of zonoidal or zonotopic structure. And non-negative matrix factorization says we like pyramids or simplices. So again, there's axes associated with these, but they're not like orthogonal axes. They're like the extreme rays of a tetrahedron, only this is up in high dimensions, and so you can't see it all. I'm just giving you a low-dimensional equivalent of what these models are suggesting. So the idea behind each one of these is that you're fitting a geometric structure to high-dimensional data, and you get axes that help you summarize the data, give you a new coordinate system. In some cases, they're not orthogonal axes, and in any event, the structures that lead to these are not based on the traditional ellipsoidal models. Let me give you an example of one of these, and I want to pay special attention to the science and how it matches with what comes out of the data analysis, because I think what makes it convincing in a hidden components model is when you cope with the issues of what I called reification. If you recall what I said before, reification is where you have something and just because it has a name, you believe it. The question is always, do the things that come out of these analysis, for example, these axes, are they real in some way? Okay, well, here's some place where we can answer that. Okay, Bruno Olshausen at UC Davis and David Field at Cornell are modern academic psychologists. So instead of dealing with testing of individuals, they're dealing with particular issues of how the visual system works. And they had a paper that appeared some years ago in Nature where they took a collection of natural images and they extracted little image patches of the kind I was talking about before, made a database of patches, and then applied sparse components analysis. So essentially what they're doing is they're saying, I have a database of images and I want axes which are the coordinate system that's adapted to images themselves. Like, what is the coordinate system that images are asking for? Is there anything there of interest? So I gave these examples before of how you could extract image patches and come up with them and build a database. Okay, when you do principal components analysis on that database, here's what you get. And anybody with a good mathematical background sees immediately that you're getting sinusoids. And that can be explained in a very natural way based on the kind of so-called tuplets structure that the covariance is going to have. However, clearly, this is not getting at a very good representation of what the images are like. What Olshausen and Field found by sparse components analysis is the following picture. So remember, we're up in 16 by 16 image patches puts us in a 256 dimensional space. And every object in 256 space can be represented in terms of 256 basis elements. Each one of those basis elements corresponds to an image, because we're in a space of images. And here, essentially, we're saying every image can be built by linear combinations of these things, by essentially adding these up with weights. And if you do that, what you see is you have things that are at all different scales and all different orientations and locations. So it's a family of things that are multi-scale, multi-orientation, and by combining them, you can make any image you want. And this is the coordinate system that the images naturally ask for if you want to sparsely represent the images using as few coordinates as possible on the typical image. So in some sense, you get the best compression of images if you use this particular case, when you're dealing with these small image patches. Now, when they first came out, their first title before they published was that these are wavelets. And they are a multi-scale system, but they're not exactly what mathematicians call wavelets in the traditional sense. And I'll say more about that a little later. Okay, you can also ask for what are the sparse components of natural movies and apply the same principle. So let me quickly show that. Hans von Hatteren, a biologist in Holland, collected a database of things like BBC nature films and cultural productions coming from BBC, and then out of that extracted movie patches, little 12 by 12 by 12 patches of movie. And so you can see that some of these are nature scenes and images of animals walking around and so on. And then the little movie patches will be played now. And what you'll see is the typical, these are just little small things and they don't last very long. So they're little movielets, right? And what you have is you might see something moving across the image, you know, or you might see nothing. Okay, but anyway, those are the typical elements of this database. And the question is, what is the set of axes to most sparsely represent these movies? So now they'll show those. This is what comes out. And what you get is a multi-scale, multi-orientation system. It's also multi-velocity. And so what you have is objects that have a certain orientation and a certain location and scale. There's things in different widths and so on. And they also move at different speeds in different directions.
Universe?
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so each basis function is a movie itself, and all movies can be made by linear combinations. It turns out you're in 1728 dimensional space, so you'd have to watch 1700 of these movies in order to see everything go by. We won't do that today. Okay, so that's Hans von Hatteren's work. Now, reification. Why do we think any of these things are real? Well, first of all, we could go to biology. There's a single neuron experiments have been conducted by Hubel and Wiesel, and essentially what you do is you paralyze an animal like a cat, and you stick an electrode into the back of their brain where the visual cortex is. You show them stuff, and you see what makes those neurons respond. And through trial and error, they discovered that the kind of stimuli that make the neurons respond are exactly a multi-scale, multi-orientation sort of little needle things. And so now there's this ice cube model of the visual cortex, and it shows that there's neurons that respond to things that have various different orientations colored here, and this has all been mapped out. So actually, we know that what's coming out of this sparse components analysis matches the single neuron studies to a significant degree. And these are not, you know, fake ideas. A second way to validate these ideas would be to do some math analysis. And I just mentioned briefly some work I did with Immanuel Condes, where we said, okay, so could we use math and figure out what is the best representation for sparse representation of images. Not doing data analysis, but doing it by a mathematical analysis. So we developed a system called curvelets that had anisotropic multiscale multi-orientation character and showed that basically this was the right way to get the sparsest representation for images that corresponded to continuum images having edges. So in fact, we were able to match up pretty convincingly what comes out of this sparse components analysis with what comes out of this mathematical analysis, seeking the best theoretical compression of images in a theoretical model. So the idea emerging from sparse components analysis also makes sense from that point of view. Okay, I have also now I want to talk about another generalization where instead of assuming, PCA assumes either that you're ellipsoidal or that you're in a hyperplane. So we've talked about how you can get away from the ellipsoidal assumption. Now I want to talk about getting away from the hyperplane assumption. And I realize I'm running out of time, so I'll try to do it very quickly. Okay. So now let's think. We're used to the idea now that images can make databases, and I want you to think about a particular kind of database where the images are all basically of the same scene, but the difference between the images has to do with some underlying parameter that's changing. An example would be that a person is changing the tension in the muscles of their face. So each, there's, let's say, 60 muscles in the face that matter for your expressions. They're parameters of how tense those muscles are, and you articulate the face through 60 numbers, basically. Similarly, if you're writing out the letter 3, there's some underlying parameters. Or we could have a cartoon model where there's just some simple object like a cartoon ball, and it moves around in a play world, and the parameter of the center is just an XY. Those are all examples where there's a family of images similar except for some underlying parameter changing. Okay, well, anytime that happens, then the images that you're interested in can be viewed as living on a manifold up in some high-dimensional space. Remember that images are up in this high-dimensional space. And as you, for example, rotate an image, you move from one image to another, it must be moving you around in that high-dimensional space. But it's going to be doing it in a gradual way that mathematicians call manifold. And different pictures will each move along their own manifold under the influence of these parameters articulating. Okay, so one problem would be like the following. We've got this high-dimensional data up in some high dimension. We can't even see it. And we know there are parameters underlying it. And what we'd like to do is understand, can we recover the parameters? So there's a family of algorithms that go back to the ideas from Gauss and Riemann and Nash and so on that I mentioned, where given just the abstract metric information of how similar the different images are, we can recover some presentation in a low-dimensional space. And then we'd like to know, like, for example, is there any relationship between what this algorithm is doing and the real parameters, like the muscles of the face? Have we reified a false thing, or do we have a real thing that we're discussing? Is there a relationship here? Okay, so how would you even measure distances between images? Well, if the images lie on a manifold, what you do is you find nearby images and you find ways to get from one image to another by walking from nearby image to other nearby image. And I've just depicted this here with some low-dimensional example to indicate traveling along a manifold. What I mean, the images manifolds we're interested in are not bunnies. They sit up in high-dimensional space, and this is just a cartoon to remind us. So just to mention some things that I've been involved in, if you take little cartoon worlds where there's some simple parameters that correspond to the different kinds of images you could have, you can make them complicated, like cartoon faces where there's an outline for the mouth that's under the control of some parameters, and there's eyebrows that are under control of parameters and so on. So you have one of these worlds. in all of these cases, there's instances of these models where the articulation manifolds sit abstractly in this high-dimensional space are actually isometric to Euclidean space. They're not flat, so they aren't hyperplanes up in high-dimensional space, but they are like taking a flat piece of paper and twisting it. And so that's true for a wide range of these manifolds. And so one strategy to learn about these high-dimensional manifolds would be to actually find a flat isometric copy and present that to somebody, and then they can understand it using Euclidean space. So there's a nice algorithm that was published in Science, December 2000. Josh Tenenbaum and Vin De Silva were at Stanford at the time. He's now at MIT, and Vin is looking for a postdoc somewhere. The method of ISOMAP exactly does this. It uses classical multidimensional scaling, but in addition, it uses those ideas of the bug's distance walking around on the data manifold. Here's a typical result. There's pictures that show they were just a hand going through certain articulations, and it turned out that that the way the database was gathered, the hand, either it was open or closed, and either it was twisted or not. And you just throw a whole bunch of pictures into a database, run it with this ISOMAP algorithm, and it finds a way to map this down into a two-dimensional space by unfolding the manifold of images, and this is what you get. And so you see that it's actually uncovered that one axis is really wrist rotation and the other one is finger extension. It just comes out of the data naturally by uncovering the structure of the manifold. Now, there's a little proviso, which is that the ISOMAP algorithm only works when you sample the manifold very well. And in work that I've done, we discovered a way to deal with the problem where the manifold is not uniformly sampled. So say we had a piece of paper crumpled up, you know, twisted like this, and it had a hole in it. ISOMAP wouldn't actually recover that it was a piece of paper, but would distort it. But a technique that we developed called Hessian eigenmaps would actually just unroll it and not worry about the hole. Okay, so there are a variety of techniques. And let me just indicate for you what could be at stake here by showing some results that I think are quite interesting that were done at MIT. So let me first explain. So at MIT, they hired this attractive young model, and they asked her to speak for about 8 minutes, some prepared phrases. So she had to say, ah, oh, e, you know, so on and so forth, s, ha, you know, everything. And then that gave them enough movie database of her that they could then construct, in some sense, the manifold of movies that she could make by articulating her face. Okay, and in addition, they could label places on that manifold according to the different vowels and fricatives and things that she's saying. Okay, once they've got the manifold mapped out and they've got it labeled, then they can do text to speech. That is, they can take text and they can have her say things which she never said in real life. Okay. And if you go to Tommy Poggio's website, P-O-G-G-I-O at MIT, you can download this movie, and there's many other materials there. But in addition, she can actually sing songs that she never sang.
When I get home with one small step.
Now look at her mouth very carefully. This is all synthetic. She never sang this. Around here you can see small glitches. It's not perfect. And then there's only a few things she does with her eyes, and they're not synced to the emotion of the song. So there are things that aren't perfect.
wants to be.
But if you do the lip reading, it really works. So again, for 8 minutes, you just watch a person, basically. You map out the manifold, and then you can make them say things they never said. In fact, in languages, they even know. So this is Japanese, I think. Okay, so just for my conclusions here, we're entering this era of very high dimensional data, factors across all of science and technology. Learning the structure of the underlying data is a top priority in all of those fields. Principal components has been a crucial tool all along for the last 100 years, but there are new methods that are being developed because modern data can have structure that's different. It doesn't have to have that ellipsoidal structure. It doesn't have to be living in a flat linear subspace. So new methodologies are being developed all the time, which I thought you might want to know about. And the possibilities implicit in this for all sorts of scientific and technological advances, I think, are rather large, and I hope that you'll make some of those. Thank you.
The last example that you show is a very interesting example, but I have some questions. You are saying that you can make that person to sing or to say something which she has never said, or to sing a song which she has never sung. Now, if that person happened that she would not be able to sing, and she has no musical ability and cannot sing. So can you verify that when she does sing, would it be the same that you have produced? I think that is something probably difficult or uncompatible, because she actually cannot sing. Whereas if you make her to speak something, and then you can verify when she does speak, and right, that she actually the same, come up with the same kind of a sound that she make.
Okay, so first, it's a great question. Secondly, I just want to do a clarification, is that she was not actually, the model was chosen for her looks, not her voice. So the songs that I played was not her voice in any sense. Those were pop songs. One was by Dido, which is, I think, American, and the other one, Hikaru, which I think Japanese. So, but your point stands, because there's the following thing. We're making her face articulate in ways that are different. You know, it's not a recording of her. We're putting together articulations by moving through this manifold. And it's actually possible that if she had to do the motion, she wouldn't go by the same path, right? So it's like saying, when I go home to the hotel, right, maybe you have a good idea how I should go, right? But maybe I'm not a good, I don't know Singapore that well, and you would probably take a shortcut where you go on Clooney Road by the Botanic Garden, and I would go on Farrer Road and get caught in the traffic, right? Something like this. So the point is, on this manifold, they're actually going by shortest path. So they find this manifold in high dimension, and if they need to get from this syllable to that syllable, they go by shortest path, right? Now, as far as we know, there's no reason that a facial expression must go by shortest path between two points. And I can imagine there would be very talented actors who do unexpected things, on purpose. So it might particularly be very bad to try to mimic, you know, a famous actor who would do unexpected things with the face. But maybe, you know, the average person maybe just does something very simple to get from one place on the manifold to the other. And maybe someone more wily, more sophisticated, does something a little unpredicted. In that case, the individual personality of the actor would be something that would not be captured through this approach. And you're exactly right. You could check it. You have a predicted facial articulation, and then you could actually watch it, and you might see that for some people the prediction was not good. It'd be quite interesting to do that experiment.
Some principal components are missing. Emotional, for example.
They only measure for a few minutes. And then the stimuli that they give her have no emotions in them. They simply say, speak, you know, speak this word. So there may be many ways that she could speak, and she could be sad, she could be happy, and all of this. And they're not probing any of that. So the eerie part of all of that video is that it's a song which has emotional content, and you know, her brow is very flat. Right? She's not reacting to any of the words that she's saying. So that would not go. You couldn't make a real music video out of this, because they would have to be hamming it up and creating all that extra content. But maybe in the future someone will learn how to model the part of an image manifold that's due to articulation of emotions. Who knows?
They look real, very good, you know, expressions, everything.
Yeah, that's a good question. I think Shrek, it's only computer assisted. So what I think that they do in Shrek is that there's an animator, and if you look at, in, you know, really they have like the forehead wrinkling, and they do a lot of very dramatic gestures. And that's cartoonists who, you know, spend their whole career learning about those gestures. But they use the computer to do what's called tweening, which moves you between one frame and another. And so in some sense, they're navigating this manifold with the guidance of an expert. And then he just uses little short steps where the computer helps. But he doesn't trust the computer to do everything. I think that it'd be interesting to know.
May I ask a quick question? Thank you very much, Professor, for your explanation of the principal component technique. I'm doing research using this method, but I'm not an expertise on this area, so I would like to ask you a technical question. I have two groups of data, post and pre-event analysis, and then I did principal component and extract the factors for these two group of data. Then I would like to know whether there's a technique, a method to do the statistical comparison between these two extracted factors. Thank you.
Okay, it's a good question. I think I briefly mentioned earlier in the talk that statisticians have been interested in exactly the question of, is a difference real? Or is an effect that you think you're seeing in these components real? And in fact, here at this university, there are people who are very interested in exactly the properties of what is effectively the principal components of very large random matrices. And so I just want to mention that there are plenty of people here who are experts on exactly your question. There are techniques for comparing the principal component solutions from two different data sets, or from comparing the principal scores of two different groups. And maybe the best thing to do would be we talk about your problem offline and then match those things up. But definitely there are some good experts here at the university for for your question. So you have a bright future in that regard.
I don't see in the audience. Spy here. No. Well, maybe, what do you think? Maybe we should call it a day. I think it's running late. I think it's a very fascinating talk. I mean, the breadth, it's amazing. I think it's very hard for anyone to match you with that kind of breadth. Anyway. Let's thank Professor Donohue again.